Toby. Oh, okay. He's breaking into the wall. Meaning all of us are all sinners. All of us. That's what I'm preaching about, because last week I explained here, remember what? What did I preach about last week? Last week, do you
remember last week's
sermon? The word of God touches the heart. Oh, yeah. Exercise to help you feel better. Medicine. Christians, Jesus' Bible influences different. No, just one. It's just one.
Counselor, when you sit with a counselor and you go through the Word of God, what my own opinion calls your idea of no. Understand how we can meet with a counselor. If there's marriage problems, or there's internal problems, there's mental problems, if you have anything, you should meet with someone who uses the Word of God. That's what I was explaining last week. Before we start, I want to explain things like how we grow, how we succeed for God. It's important that we recognize this, that we are all sinners. First, that's the first step. We'll discuss all these different points about it. Romans chapter 3. We'll look at this and you'll be able to understand it. Modern day, we have problems. All these different problems. Because we're all sinners. Even Christians. I pray that we'll be able to think and say, oh, we did preach about this before. Yeah. Total deprivation. Depravity, that we're full of sin, but this is more in depth. Each individual person and each individual person's issues. Pray. Father, Lord, praise you. Thank you for your word that you have given to us. We pray that we'll be able to hear your word and think upon it so that everything may work out, Lord. We pray that we will be able to look and wonder and look to you when we need you, Lord. counselors that solve these different things and help us understand that, hey, it's because we are sinners. Give us the wisdom to preach the word. Thank you in Jesus' name. I'll let you know that some people say we're all sinners. And the second group of people say that when babies are born, they're perfect. They're honest, there's no sin in them. When they're born, they're already sinners. Some people say no, and they'll disagree with you. But there's proof in the Word of God. I'll give you all these different verses. Chapter 1 through 8, they're talking about how to become perfect, about grace. We want to look at the center of this. Chapter 9 through 20, they discuss all these different things. Paul says, what then? Are we Jews that any better off? No, not at all. For we have already charged that all means that we're already charged, all of us, being punished. It doesn't matter if they're just Jews. It's not about your ethnicity. It's both Jews and Greeks. Jewish and the non-Jewish. It usually said us as Greeks or Gentiles. It means non-Jewish. Are under sin. It means that we are being punished because we are full of sin. I changed it to make it a little better and understandable. The New Testament. New Testament, NLT. All the people in the globe, all the people, babies included, are already sinners and need to be punished. They've already sinned. They know. Are perfect and good. But is that really true? Maybe they should use a different English word. But there is none. It says all people, whether Jews or Gentiles, non-Jewish, are under the power of sin. We are underneath. Means that sin has already taken a control of our lives. We are under their control. Sin is a part of us already. It's already clung to us. Because of Adam and Eve. Because they rebelled against God and they started the first sin. By rebelling against God, they've already sinned and it's spread. It doesn't go away. It continues. It's traditionally given. It's given till the end of time. Sin, when it becomes a part of us, has all these different things that cause us to rebel. You say somebody is perfect and incredible. Okay, fine. Do they go to church? Oh, no. That's still a rebellion. Oh, he gives the church and they're incredible and they give all of their stuff. Okay, that's true. Do they love Jesus? They say, yeah, okay. Do they obey? Do they give up something? And they're like, oh, no. They're still sinners. All of us are under sin. important to say is that babies are also sinners. People say, oh, they're moms, they don't have Noah yet. They can't rebel. When they're born, when you first little baby, they start to rebel. They've already sinned. They should be happy and endure and be patient. They can't do that. They're babies. They get angry. Or if you lay them down, they won't sleep. That's rebellion. Resistance. You feed them, they'll say, oh, I don't want that food. I hate it. You'll resist. It's good for them. They must eat it. They resist. It's already a sin. You can't just accept it no matter what. Even if you're not have no sin, they have to endure. They sleep, they're like, okay, I'll force myself to sleep. There's no baby like that. Everybody is the same. The only one who was perfect was Jesus. He had no sin. People are all sinners. Chapter 3. So I'm jumping down to 19. Now we know that whatever the law says, it speaks to those who are under the law. It means that if sin is a part of us, we are already under its law. We're being punished under its law. We must obey and follow. So that every mouth may be stopped. And the whole world. It means everybody. All people may be accountable to God. It means that when we talk or what we think or what we do is brought to God. He'll ask us, why did we do all these different things? And we'll think, oh, well, we thought you couldn't see that. But he already knew, and he'll list all of these. Why didn't you reprimand? Why did you continue to sin? It's incredible. You might think it's nothing and think that God will forgive you. But when you die and you're confronted by him, and then he says you haven't reprimanded yet. We as Christians as well must be held accountable. We practice sin. We have to bring it to him. Change things to make it a little easier. The law applies to all people to whom it is given. For its purpose is to keep people from having excuses. It means we can't say, I can't help it, I'm weak, blah, blah, I'm a sinner, I can't help it. Or, oh, I've been tempted, I can't help it. We'll ask for excuse after excuse after excuse. But the law says no. They don't accept an excuse. You've broken the law, then you must be punished. If I kill someone, and they catch you, they're like, okay, you killed someone. They'll say, yeah, you have fingertips that match the crime scene, you have the blood. Your body, you have all this for proof. So they'll say you do it. And they have a bunch of witnesses. It's this person. They have the proof. They have everything against you. You can't say it's not you because there's the proof. It means you put in jail for life. Or you have the death penalty. God was, you can't say but to God. He will tell us what we did. We might try to give excuses. And he says, no, you did, and that's it. When I teach at my high school, people say, we'll try to twist it. He'll say, I know you're just trying to get the better of me. Oh, they'll say, oh, my DVD doesn't work. And he's like, oh, you have internet. sometimes they'll say, oh, I don't have a book. You have a book at home. You have a book here. You can do the work. They give excuse after excuse. I say, no. Once in a while, I'll say no. I'll say, okay, I'll accept it. But most of the time, it's no. There's no excuse. The law is established. We can't say but to the law. That's why the verse says that we must be humble, and quiet, and look. And when he lists all our different sins, we say, okay, and accept them. And to show that the entire world is held guilty before God. My dad, I asked him how he will get into heaven. He's like, oh, I'll just be a good man. With Jesus, you become good. And he's like, no, I myself am good. And I will go to heaven because I am good. He's alcoholic. He's cheated. He doesn't support righteous causes. He ignores his children. He neglects them. Does that make him a good man? Not at all. He was a bad man. He was not a good father. Because he's a sinner. He's brought before God's court. You have to look to yourself and realize you're a sinner. Now, verse 9 and 10 says, as it is written, Paul already studied the Old Testament from Genesis to Malachi. Studied it all. It is the law. And in Levi, all these different things, they have laws coming all the way up. Look, Malachi himself was a Pharisee. He went to university and had a PhD degree. He was established. He knew all these different things. He studied. As it is written. It's already been done. None is righteous. No one is perfect. No, not one. People as a whole are all full of bad. All of us are bad. Terrible. Chapter 1, Paul explains how to open and praise God because he's picked us to become his disciples, to spread the gospel. And then in 16, he says, there's no shame in the gospel. I love God. And in 17, he says, for it is in the righteousness of God to be revealed in faith for faith as it is written. The righteous shall live by the faith. He says that. Paul says that. It's written, when I preach, I always look back to the Bible. I'll preach from the Bible. People say, I said that, or they said that. Some people say, oh, God said that. You can't give stories and their ideas and look to them. My ideas and my opinions are cool. That's not right. I'll look at YouTubes or emails or Facebook. What people say, no, I disagree. I'll say, okay, fine. If you disagree, that's okay. It's not my word. It's not my word. I just give you the Bible, and if you disagree with God, that's you. It's not me. I preach. Sometimes there's a discussion, they're like, oh, that's your opinion. I'll say, oh, okay. It's my opinion. Where's my opinion from? My opinion's from God. My ideas are not my own. I've studied to make sure that I follow His word. I know I am not perfect. I'm not perfect. I'm dependent on Him and the Holy Spirit to preach. That's very important that we look and depend on Him. We can't depend on ourselves. We're nothing. That's why Paul wrote this. It is written. It has already been said in the Bible. If you disagree, look to the Bible. What's interesting is I've been reading Quiet Time with God. I've been studying verses from Acts all the way forward. I've been reading all of them. I've been captured by His word. All people who use how to defend yourself. The Bible. If people try to, there's no like, oh, buts or telling stories. But it's all using the gospel and preaching using the gospel and teaching using the gospel. Do you think, oh, I must be caught and punished? That's their responsibility to God. I've preached to them. If they want to know if it's the truth or not, they can. But otherwise, oh, the Jews and the Pharisees, they're discussing, they're listening to lies. And they'll follow them. They'll follow Jesus. All people are sinners, and they're dependent on the Word of God. They must use Scripture. When I preach, I always use Scripture. Sometimes I make mistakes. And I'll do it again next Sunday. I'll re-explain. Maybe a bit more clear, because I don't want to spread wrong words. A long time ago, 2007 maybe, I had a sermon full of mistakes. One pastor came to me and said, hey, you did this wrong. And I looked at it and I was like, oh, I have to delete it. But it's already spread. It's my responsibility. We don't need the leaven. No one and none. At the very center, it says this. It's not what I, Paul, am saying. It's what the Bible is saying. It's written, none is righteous. No, not one. There's no one. Well, there's one person who is perfect. There's no one person. Are you or me perfect? Am I a pastor perfect? No, there's no one. Point is, never rebel. Always fully obey 100% and follow. And be perfect that way. Do I follow God 100%? No. I struggle. Because sin is a part of me. I'm born with sin. I grow and I struggle. I stray. I'll ignore God, and I'll focus on what I want, what the world wants. I'm supposed to look to God and follow Him. But I get tempted because the devil's trying to sway me. Something will look good. The trees, the stories. Oh, that tree looks lovely. holding on to God. I'm trying to get sin. From 11 it says, no one understands. No one already knows God and knows everything about him or completely understands him. You gotta think, really? You're still conveying your own ideas and thinking that you have a better way to life than with God. Some people say all the churches are wrong. They'll say, I understand. But they're still rebelling against God. Sin is a part of them. No one seeks for God. Many people have told me, I went searching for God. I searched for him. They'll go to different churches. They'll go to another one. They'll go to another one. It's impossible. Our spirits, if we die, will wake up and search? No, we can't. There's nothing. God himself touches our hearts. And then it's done. We do not need looking for other things to match with. He's searching. If whether it's Hindu or Buddhist or Islam or Jewish, we're searching for something that we think is perfect. But there is nothing. It's impossible. God has to become a part of us so that we may understand. You know the song about grace? Amazing grace. I was blind and now I see. Blind means people don't understand. They don't understand God. They don't understand what he does. But now I finally can understand because Jesus has become a part of me. We understand, or we're searching without his help. It's impossible. No one seeks for him. Some people say we search for him. People say, oh, but do you think about Jesus? Are you a sinner? Did Jesus die on the cross for you because you're a sinner and accept your punishment? You need to believe in Jesus, that he is the Son of God. And they will understand. And you will understand. And they will be saved. You can't say that you search for God. It's impossible. We as sinners are worthless. We're not perfect. We don't understand. We don't search. And we are worthless. Sin, once it becomes a part of us, causes us to turn aside, to stray from the path. Together, they will become worthless. Once we turn away, they become worthless. We become sick. We become skewed. We become fools. Stupid fools. No one does good. Not even one. This is from Psalms 14, 1 through 3, before it was Romans 3, 12. It's interesting. The world, as a whole, there's so many problems, right? There's murder, there's stealing. There's messed up things. See all this different stuff. And there will be some people that are rich and famous, and their name is glorified because of sin. All people have turned aside. fall straight in our thinking about what we want. We want to be rich. We want to just kill, destroy people. I want to steal people. I want to kill people. I want all these different things. And the list goes on and on. Some people have already done that before. And then in the future, we might get straight as well. Means that together we are worthless. We thank God for Jesus becoming a part of us, that we may be holy and become perfect. When Jesus is not a part of us, we are not perfect. Chapter 13 says, "Their throat is an open grave." They use their tongues to deceive. It's talking about when they talk or when they sign, when they speak. They can cancel people. They can put people down. They can offend people. They can use themselves. From Psalms 5:9. Sometimes we are hit with lying or something, or we'll be offending somebody, or we'll do something. It's because in our hearts we're sinners. We grow up. We become Christians. We're supposed to destroy from that. The venom. You know, snake venom? Will fall over and die. The venom of asps is under their lips. What's what you say? There's somebody that can see you. They're like, oh, they'll talk bad about this one person. They're like, hey, and then it'll spread. It's gossip. It's a rumor. And they'll look down on this person, even though this person did nothing wrong. Came up with that. Oh, it came from that person. That person started it. Spread to all the people around this person. I'm sure that all of us have experienced that. They're like, oh, but I've done nothing wrong. Because people in the system are sinners. It helps me understand when I look at it. Why all these people do this? People are full of sin. Mouth is full of filthy. Signs are dirty, or rough, or offensive, or lies. They're full of curses and bitterness. Bitterness, anger. The mouth is the same thing as sign. We're talking about speaking. People's words. Psalm 10:7. It says, but now we must. All of us as Christians, we have to put them all away. Get rid of them. Anger. Wrath. Malice. Slander. And obscene talk from your mouth. Full of curses and bitterness. Some Christians will have so much obscenity. I have to stop eventually. It's a little bit fine. It's not Christian films. So once in a while it happens, it's okay. But if it continues to happen over time, it's enough. I can't do it. I don't want this to become part of my brain. I want to be constantly thinking about it. I won't sign curses. I ignore it. It's because of TV clicking stuff. As Christians, we must put them all away. There's two paths that we have. Verse, it talks about control and controlling what we say. Nothing is just a little thing. Little things become big things. This verse we have to be careful of. From the same mouth comes blessing and cursing. These things ought not to be so. Oh, praise God, it's a blessing. Like, oh, you're ugly. You're stupid. Why? You shouldn't talk like this. You shouldn't have both mixed up. You should bless. Be positive. Thank you, Jesus. You're punished by people who don't obey. People are put down and they'll offend other people. They'll say, oh no, that's wrong, you should look at the Bible, and they'll say this. If you're being stupid, no, you shouldn't speak of corrections. But you shouldn't try to offend them and put them down. And they say, oh, that person's awful, and they'll tell them about this person. Like, hi, God blesses you. Oh, praise God, thank God that you're here. And then you go to somebody else and say, oh, the church on Sunday is so stupid. I keep saying blessed, but they're really stupid. Shouldn't talk like that. I've seen Christians do it all the time. Switch between the two. Most people are good. They love God very strongly. They keep positive. They'll correct other Christians. They'll pray for the change of heart. We can't have two faces. The mouth is full of curses. Instead of part of us, we're full of obscenities. We're putting people down. Even more, murder, ruin, and misery. It means awful sin. Chapter 15 says, their feet are swift to shed blood. It's English, but it means they're ready to kill. They really want to kill. Interesting. I've killed no one, but in the back of my head, I want this person to die. They'll think that. That's the same thing. I hate so much. That's the same thing as killing someone. John says, you must love your brother, but if you talk negatively against them, you hate them. That's the same thing as killing. You must be very careful. It doesn't matter if you talk it or think it or actually do it physically. That person who walks on this path, their path are ruin and misery. teachers were swearing. They like, but you're supposed to be a churchgoer. It's an extreme difference. Some people act like this, and you don't want to be a part of that person's life because of how they act. You must be very careful. Sin is a part of us. We as Christians know this. We have to protect ourselves from it. The way of peace. They don't know it. They sin and kill people. I think it's fine. This is from Isaiah 59, verse 7 through 8. No fear of God. Some people think fear means to be afraid. That's not the meaning. There's two different meanings. One is fear, like actual fear, like as in afraid. And the other one is awe. And respect. And thinking something is so amazing that you have to be separated from it. Fear of God is thinking that somebody is so amazing that I cannot rebel against them. They are so amazing. I cannot sin, and I'll beg for their forgiveness. People have no fear. No fear of God. People stray from church. Yesterday morning, I was shocked. You know Joshua Harris? He wrote books. Oh, I Kiss Dating Goodbye. He's a writer. Talking about how we become part of God with a relationship as well. It's about dating God. Some stuff is good information that helps us so that we can honor God. But many people looked at him and said, no, I disagree. Because the man himself travels preaching to different churches. He's been married and he has children. 2 weeks ago, they decided to get divorced. What's worse is, he has left God. He used to preach at the church and used to be part of the gospel. But in his heart, he had no fear. mother, in sin did my mother conceive me. David recognized this. He said, I'm a sinner, I know. I'll follow and obey you. David's heart was touched, and he apologized, and he sent for a commendation. He asked for his heart to be cleansed. He has fear. Jeremiah 32:40 is a very good verse. Help us remember. And I encourage you to memorize this verse. God said, I will make them an everlasting covenant. Those who believe I will not turn away from fear. Wait, from doing good to them. And I will put fear of me. Doing good to them. Plus, I will put the fear of me. In their hearts. We have to honor them. We can't leave them or rebel against them. I must stay. I must stay with them. We love them. But if we sin, we have to apologize and beg for forgiveness. We look to him always, every day. And we disregard and say, oh, God understands me. Fine. They have no fear. If they think of him as incredible and look to him, they have fear. Some people say, oh, there's a new culture in this modern day. We can't help it. It means that they have no fear. I plan on preaching about fear later. But sin causes us to have no fear. We sin and do whatever we want. Every mouth may be stopped. The whole world may be accountable to God. We all have guilt. For by works of the law, no human being, no person, shall be justified. Follow the law constantly, and they're perfect. Perfectly following, and they're practicing the law. But in our hearts, we're full of evil, full of sin. Through the law, we know sin. The law being the Bible. We must use it to recognize that we're sinners. The Bible helps us change so that we destroy from the world's things and destroy from sin. We must look to ourselves as sinners and say we need Jesus. I depend on him for everything. If we've sinned against, we must beg forgiveness, or we ask forgiveness. We must. Disregarded. We're just continuing to be sinners. Say, oh, I'm sorry. Where is your knowledge of God's word? Where is he a part of you? We should feel guilty and realize that we're not perfect. I'm not perfect. I have mistakes. It doesn't show what I do. I've been working hard. Check myself against. Sometimes I'll stray, but I'll come back. We have fear. That's why we come back. Fear is so important. That we'll think upon it and look to ourselves and realize that we're sinners. Baby borns, they're also sinners. Pray. Father, Lord, thank you for your word, for helping us study chapter 3 and sins that cause us our guilt. Hope that we can look to you and realize that there's problems in this world because there's sin. There's no fear. That we'll have fear with you, Lord, so that we can look to you and honor you. I know that we are sinners. I know that we feel guilt, but forgive us so that we cannot not look to you. And so that we may always go to you. Use us to spread your gospel so that we, more people may look to you and be brought to your in Jesus. Next week, we'll be more openly discussing this and more positive about Jesus. Lord, I know today is a little bit crazy. Lord, I hope your word will guide us and help us think about how we should live for you. Thank you for everything you do for us. We pray in Jesus' name. So that you'll give up your sin. You gave to our sins so that we would not be punished. Thank you for everything. So you may look to us and touch our hearts so that we may look to you. Please look to us to make sure that we are, to know we are sinners. Thank you in Jesus' name.